Greetings, everyone. I am Dr. Poornima Prabhakaran, Deputy Director of the Center for Environmental Health at the Public Health Foundation of India. On behalf of the India International Center and the Public Health Foundation of India, it is my privilege and pleasure to welcome you all to the next edition of IISc's Diamond Jubilee discussions on the pandemic and climate change. Today, the topic of our session is poor equality and impacts on health. And we are delighted to have with us a very distinguished panel of speakers who will help throw light on what is seen today as a very important public health issue. Not so long ago, India had the dubious distinction of being known as the diabetes capital of the world. But the World Health Organization has now stated that 15 of the 20 most polluted cities in the world are now in India, and that includes Delhi, the capital city. With that, we now have the distinction of being the air pollution capital of the world. This is indeed worrisome. India has seen close to 1.6 million deaths due to air pollution in recent years, a good amount of it due to exposure to ambient air pollution. Intuitively, we think that the impacts on health are on our lungs, in other words, on the respiratory health of populations. But in recent times, we have seen a growing evidence base and research pointing to the impacts of health across the life course, which means not just in adult health or on child health, but across the life course, starting from as early as neonatal health up to adult and elderly illnesses. The naysayers, however, exist in India, and we are repeatedly hearing in different fora that the evidence base on the impacts of poor air quality on human health is not enough. We hope in the session today that our panelists will help to allay those fears and bust the myths that exist. We have with us today clinicians, public health practitioners, environmental health advocates, and a parent to bring a very different perspective to the discussion on air quality and health. Today, we are joined by Professor Dr. Kiran Guleria, who's the director, professor, and unit head, Department of Obstetrics and Gynaecology, University College of Medical Sciences, and GTB Hospital, Delhi. Welcome, Dr. Guleria. We also have with us Dr. H. Paramesh, a well-known pediatric pulmonologist, who's currently visiting professor at the Divecha Center for Climate Change at the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. We also welcome Dr. Paramesh. We have with us Dr. Khilnani, formerly with the All India Institute of Medical Sciences and now chairman, PSRI Institute of Pulmonology, Critical Care and Sleep Medicine. Welcome, Dr. Khilnani. We have with us Dr. Prabhakaran, formerly cardiologist at All India Institute of Medical Sciences and now Vice President, Research and Policy at the Public Health Foundation of India. Welcome, Dr. Prabhakaran. Joining us today is also Mr. Manjeet Saluja, who is the National Professional Officer, Environment, Climate Change and Public Health in the WHO India office in New Delhi. It's my pleasure and privilege to welcome today also a very special guest, Mrs. Bavreen Kandari, who is a Delhi-based environmentalist and member of a group that has been increasingly seen in the space, raising their voices for environmental issues, warrior moms. Welcome, Bavreen. Thank you for joining us today. We're going to start today with five pace setter talks where our obstetrician, our pediatrician, our pulmonologist, and our cardiologist are going to give us a high-level overview of the current evidence base on the health impacts of air pollution as it pertains to India. We're going to then be joined by Mr. Manjeet Singh Saluja and Bavreen, and we will discuss through a panel discussion some very pertinent questions on the way air quality impacts health and how the issue is being addressed in India, not just from the program and policy space, but also from the health perspective. So we start with Dr. Guleria, and ma'am, we request you to provide your perspectives on the impacts of poor air quality on pregnant women and neonatal health.
Thank you very much. And at the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Poornima for inviting me to be part of this prestigious panel in Diamond Jubilee Discussions of India International Center on Pandemic and Climate Change. You know, as an obstetrician and a clinician, looking after the high-risk pregnant patients, I realized that in almost like half of the patients, I was sometimes not able to pinpoint any cause. And, you know, then that led me to believe that there was something more than what could meet the eye. And then we realized that environmental insults, you know, along with the social and the economic issues, they create a kind of triple burden on our pregnant women and as well as children in the developing nations. And so that led us to, I started into this research on the adverse, what are the adverse effects, the adverse reproductive effects of the environment on women. So initially we started with the environmental toxins that were pesticides, and we worked with them for 10 years. And now we ventured into this field of air pollution. So as you've already said, that it is a kind of global emergency. So I feel that as an obstetrician, it is a very big threat to our pregnant women, and even biggest to those individuals which you have not talked about, that is unborn children, the fetuses. I think it starts from there. And so that is why we really have to start worrying from now onwards, that is our future generation safe? Are we kind of passing on all the environmental insults to them right from their embryonic life? So that is a big question which is worrying us, because as you know that as soon as this fine particulate matter enters the circulation through your lungs, it practically kind of affects each and every organ of your body, including the fetus. Now, pregnant women form a high-risk group, extremely vulnerable because of certain physiological changes which take place during pregnancy. For example, there is increase in the respiratory rate, there is decrease in the oxygen carrying capacity, and then, you know, the females also have an increased amount of, relatively increased amount of female fat, which kind of accumulates all the environmental toxins. As a result, during pregnancy, women tend to inhale and absorb larger amount of particulate matter from the environment if the quality of air is poor. And so the effects it has on a pregnant woman and hence on the fetus are going to be magnified. So that is something which probably we, it's quite a kind of eye-opener which a lot of us do not know. So once into your system during pregnancy, you know, it creates a, I will not go into too much of, you know, scientific words, but it's kind of create a stage of what we call as increased oxidative stress. There is increased amount of inflammation. There is effect on your blood vessels, you can say. And as a result, a pregnant woman, if you know there are conditions which are called as preeclampsia, I think people may be aware of that. Then there is pregnancy-induced hypertension. Also that women have a tendency to go into labor early, which we called as preterm labor and preterm birth. They tend to rupture or they tend to leak a little early, which is called as premature rupture of membrane. But that's not all. The particulate matter enters the placenta. It, you know, the placenta, which we can say is the lungs of the fetus. So that there is almost, people have seen that there is soot in the placenta, and placenta also sometimes look as dark and gray as lungs in any polluted environment. So the fetuses also tend to have less amount of oxygen. Their nutrition also suffers because it's the kind of organ which exchanges their oxygen, their nutrition. And so there is also, they tend to grow at a less slower growth rate, which we call as fetal growth restriction. They can deliver early, so there is preterm birth. But besides that, they can also die inside the uterus. They can be stillbirths. And if it affects in the early embryonic, in their embryonic or early fetal life, then they can also have certain congenital defects, because that is a time when the fetus is growing very fast, the cells are going, so there is a, it can be a potential for teratogenesis. So there can be cardiac defects, facial structural defects. So, you know, the effects can be on mother and fetus, which are much more than, as you said, just having increased incidence of respiratory infections or exacerbation of asthma during pregnancy. So it is much more than that. In fact, it is also related to the, you know, having infertility, both in men and women. They can also experience increased amount of miscarriages. Now, it's not that, you know, we just know that this is happening. There is a lot of studies which have come from Western countries, especially, you know, from, there is a study from Barcelona, Spain, which is almost on 8,000 pregnant women, which says that if a woman is exposed to this poor air quality during the third trimester, then there is a high incidence of preeclampsia. So it's not, everything is proven in science. There is also, there are certain toxicological studies. Then there is a famous preterm birth Stockholm Environmental Institute study. So all of these point to that there are nearly 3 million babies which are born prematurely just because the quality of air is poor. So recently, you know, there are more associations seen that women in the postpartum period, if they have been exposed to the air pollution, they have increased incidence of maternal psychosis as well as postpartum depression. But the most important study which has come recently is that the various growth parameters of the fetus are affected when their mother is exposed to poor quality air, and of which head circumference is the one which gets affected. So indirectly, you know, we're trying to say probably it affects the brain growth. So we really need to see these children longitudinally to see how they do, what is their IQ, how do they fare when they grow in the, go into the schools, how is their performance, how do they do in their jobs, etc. So maybe are we kind of really adding a poor quality future generation, because today we are not able to curb these or not have enough strategies in place to combat this problem of air pollution. So it's the consequences are far-fetched. Then, you know, these are the kind of studies which are from the West. But in India also, there are a few studies which have been done on the pregnant women. And I'm very happy to share with you that we have carried out two studies. And one of them is the DAFNE, that is Delhi Air Pollution and Health Effects, where we are trying to build a cohort of 600 pregnant women. And we will follow their children for up to 18 months for development of any respiratory or other problems. So, so far, you know, we have about 200 women who have delivered in that. So I would just quickly share with you the initial results which we have concluded. But what we found is that the exposure to PM2.5 is much higher in our pregnant population, much, much higher than what is acceptable by the WHO standard. That is one. Secondly, that these women have low birth weight and preterm birth. And in fact, by about 10 units increase in PM, every 10 units increase in PM2.5 exposure decreases the birth weight by approximately 3 to 4 grams. So in actual terms, it comes out to be, you know, quite a lot. That means they are weighing less. Then also we could find that if the women are exposed in their third trimester, then they have fetal growth problems. Now, in our study, we also looked at what we call as ultrasound Doppler, that we looked at the blood flow to these fetuses during the in utero period. And we found that their blood flow also suffers. So that is why the uteroplacental flow also suffers. And so that is maybe also be the reason that you have fetal growth restrictions and preterm births. Then another interesting thing which we found in our study was that we looked at something which is called as the telomere length. So that is kind of associated with your aging. So we looked at the cord blood telomere length, and we found that it causes significant shortening. So that is very worrisome. Probably we are kind of already before they are born, they have this problem of premature, like they are, we are kind of shortening, you can say there is a shortening of their life. So they are, these are very important findings, but they are kind of in a very small population. We really need to study much more population, Indian population. But definitely there is a evidence given in the Indian population that poor quality air is not only affecting the mothers, but is affecting the fetuses who are yet to be born. So definitely there is a risk to the health and safety of the future generation. So we really have to start worrying from now onwards that is our future generation really safe? And we have to go all out to, you know, have placed the strategies to combat this air pollution, whether they are policies or where they have to be done at the personal level. And the special advisories we need to give to these women if they live in those places. So I think I'll kind of leave here,
yeah,
that at here only with this conclusion that yes, this air pollution is a big problem to our mothers, even in India. And it has a very serious health effects. It can lead to a lot of pregnancy complications, and it also leads to a lot of fetal complications, including fetal deaths and congenital malformations. So we have to start worrying. It's a real challenge in front of us. So yeah. I think I'll just leave it at that. Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Guleria, for so nicely elucidating, you know, it's not just the mothers, the pregnant mothers, but it can have long-term consequences because of the impacts that it can have on the fetus. And we all know about the, you know, the 1,000 days, you know, the exposure period, and that children affected in that time can have long-term consequences on adult health as well. So it's a really worrisome situation. And thank you so much for beautifully, you know, sharing with us the consequences on pregnancy and birth outcomes. I will move on now and invite Dr. Paramesh, who's our pediatrician. So you will see we are moving across the life course. We've started with the pregnant women and the newborn child, and we now move on to the pediatrician. Dr. Paramesh, the floor is yours. I think you have slides, and we will be sharing them from our end. Mr. Sandeep? Dr. Paramesh, please, can you unmute your mic? I think
Yes.
Yes, thank
you. I sincerely thank Poornima Prabhakaran, extending invitation for me to participate with the distinguished faculty members and distinguished participants in this conference. And also I bring the greetings from my institution. Next slide, please. I think Professor Guleria has mentioned about the impact of the air pollution. Air pollution has an impact from womb to tomb. I think nearly 70% of the environmental pollution is producing non-communicable diseases. 70% of the non-communicable disease currently air pollution. If you take that into consideration, lung being the one of the three organs where it directly exposed to the environment, it takes the greatest impact. Children suffer more because of anatomy, physiology are a little different in them. So if you take at the pulmonary upper respiratory tract, nose, sinus, middle ear infections, throat problem, bronchitis, bronchiolitis, asthma, interstitial pneumonia, all these things can come there. In addition to that, 2.5 micron, what Professor Guleria said, they cross the blood, cross the lungs, enter the bloodstream, produce small clot, produces placental coagulopathy syndrome. That leads to, depending on the seriousness of the, you can have stillbirth, you can have premature nearly 30%. You can have small for dead babies. In addition, these children born with the fixed airway obstruction. After birth, they have repeated wheezing, repeated bronchiolitis, repeated asthma, later on COPD, and end up with a long persistent asthma problem. This is one of the important things to be knowing. And also they suffer mostly the chronic cough and sudden infant death syndrome also occurs. In addition to the pulmonary problem, these, as Guleria said, 2.5 microns circulate all over the body, produces oxidative stress, various organs, including the blood pressure. This is nearly 43% of the chronic lung diseases are from the air pollution. and 29% of the lung cancer from the air pollution, and also 24% of the stroke, 25% of the heart attack related. This is a silent killer. And now we have the diabetes also come from the insulin resistant diabetes from that one, obesity and baldness related to the air pollution. In addition to that, Guleria did mention central nervous involvement. There are animal studies, enough studies to substantiate that. Increased autism, dementia, Alzheimer's, cognitive defect in anosmia, chronic headache. You are 19% of the chronic headache are related to air pollution. And behavior problem also come from the air pollution, like increased crime rate, impaired judgment, worst test scores on the polluted days, and reduction to the productivity in work has been related to that. In continuation of that, next slide, please. We have among the non-communicable diseases, respiratory allergy in children are the earliest onset non-communicable disease. Our own study shows allergic rhinitis and comorbidities increased from 22% to 40% in 2004. And in an asthmatic, that's a general pediatric population, it's gone up to 75 to now 100% of them have allergic rhinitis, asthmatic. Asthma from 1970 or 40 years, that has gone up from 9%, now it is about 28%. Persistent severe asthma gone to 24% to 72%, where they need constant medications. And persistent severe variety of asthma gone to 4% to 11%, where they need more hospitalization and mortality high in them. Next slide, please. And chronic cough has gone up from next 15.8% to 21.25%, coughing more than two weeks. And they have the comorbidities also increased. So sleep disorder breathing. And usually children snore with this one, 42.45% people with chronic cough, they snorers, and mouth breathers, 43%. And we have allergic conjunctivitis associated with that, 27.5%. We always allergic rhino-sino-conjunctivitis, all together, they're all interrelated. Bruxism, grinding of the teeth is 17%, and laryngeal dyspnea is at 3.2%. Next slide, please. And we have epidemiological data to substantiate outdoor and indoor air pollution. Outdoor air pollution, heavy traffic school children suffer more asthma. And also urban children suffer more asthma than the rural children. This same genetic stock. And asthma is increased summer months. The hypothesis is ozone related from 2% to 28% in Bangalore. Traffic police suffer most. We have that data, substantial, double the number suffer. And slow traffic, 10 km per hour, produce 6 times more carbon monoxide. Asthma virus emergency increased by 100% during Diwali festival, the bursting of the crackers. Allergic rhinitis, otitis media, sinusitis have also increased. The outdoor pollution mortality has decreased. I mean it's increased 115.3% when compared to indoor air pollution, is decreased by 64.2% as per ICMR study released in Lancet. Coming to the indoor air pollution, in ventilated huts, change in sex ratio, where double the number of girls suffer more than the boys, on the contrary of all the data available in childhood. Boys will suffer more. The asthma in ventilated house is 42%, in ill-ventilated is only 8%, we have data. And when you use the non-commercial cooking food, cow dung, is nearly 48.5 children develop asthma, electricity is only 1.2%. A single parent smokes in the house is a threefold increase in asthma in that one. Mosquito coil burning produces nearly 100 cigarette equivalent to pollution. As a single room dwelling with agriculture waste as a cooking fuel has 10.5-fold increase in pneumonia. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Having said that, I would say air pollution has a phenomenal effect. Now it is time to act because we have an emergency. Air pollution, global warming, climate change, they are all interrelated. Unless we act, we end up with a problem. Staying in this Mother Earth becomes a problem. It is time to act. It's an emergency. Thank you very much for this patient here.
Thank you, Dr. Paramesh. As always, eloquently stated, I think we've heard now from both you and from Dr. Guleria before you, I mean, the harmful effects on pregnancy as well as child health. And it's really worrisome for us as you know, as clinicians and public health researchers on the impacts that it can have on the future demographic dividend of the country. We heard about impacts on the cognitive development of children, and that is indeed worrisome. So before we move on to the panel discussion, we will now hear a little bit about the evidence base on adult health. So now I will request Professor Khilnani to take the floor and tell us his perspectives on the impacts on adult pulmonary health. Dr. Khilnani.
Yeah, so thank you IISc, and thank you Dr. Prabhakar and Dr. Srinath Reddy, who actually invited me today. Working at AIIMS in 2016, in the pre-Diwali day, I got a professor of dermatology, came into my OPD, said 4 o'clock, I got up in the morning, and I have no asthma, no blood pressure, nothing. He is a thin build. I couldn't breathe. I had soreness in my throat. I was coughing. I had to sit up and I was wheezing. When I examined him, he was actually wheezing. He was a non-asthmatic, non-smoker. These are the effects that we are used to seeing these in before the COVID time. COVID time is somehow better because air pollution has gone down, and I'll show you. And this is the India Gate that we see normally before Diwali, and this is what happens after Diwali. You can't see the sky in both, but the visibility goes down. And this was 20th April 2020, when there was complete lockdown. You can see the beautiful sky that you see in United States or, you know, when you go to developed world. So this is the kind of atmosphere that you and me are living at. And with this, I'd like to show you this lung from a person from Himachal Pradesh who underwent cardiac surgery. And this is a lung from a person living in Delhi, totally charred lung. And I would like to tell you, this person does not have lung disease per se, but he was operated for some other cause. No amount of medicine or whatever breathing exercise can bring this lung to this kind of lung. This is not to scare you, but tell you, and what Dr. Poornima said in her opening remarks, that Delhi has become most polluted, not only among the 15 cities that India, but actually Delhi is world's most polluted city. And I'm not only talking about Delhi. If you talk about air pollution, which has been my research area, there are 6 common pollutants, out of which particulate matter is most important, but this is actually secondary. It is a constellation of several, the particulate matter from kerosene would be different, from the petrol would be different, from the diesel would be different, from the cow dung burning will be different. But the nitrogen dioxide, carbon monoxide, ozone, and lead, and sulfur dioxide are the main pollutants which bother us. And it has already been talked about. It's not only that it affects lung. It affects the brain in form of strokes and dementia and Parkinson's disease. It affects eyes in terms of conjunctivitis. Heart, Dr. Prabhakaran will talk about. As far as the lung is concerned, there's nothing more proven than causes of lung cancer, which is the number one cancer killer in the world, and chronic obstructive lung disease, which is the third leading cause of death all over the world. If somebody should not think that it does not affect liver, it does not affect blood, it causes everything, including metabolic syndrome and diabetes, and even urinary system for that matter. I'll go quickly in the interest of time with the rheumatological diseases. We all in Delhi, when the pollution is bad, feel our skin becomes itchy. There's the urticaria, there is a seborrhea, and so on and so forth. And this was the paper which we wrote, and I'll talk about the Indian data in current opinion pulmonary medicine. There was increased premature deaths in India. This was a study from Lucknow. There was increased respiratory cause of mortality. This was from Delhi. And this is an increased exacerbation of obstructive airway disease and LRTI. This Dr. Pandey's study also. And there was also increased health expenditure. Coming to the sources, we are quite used to this daily traffic storm. So vehicular traffic is the main, but besides this, the industries are also adding. And although the Honorable Court driven away the industries from there. But if we talk about India, small and large industries are the big polluting areas. And of course, this parali, which we talk about everywhere and we forget once the parali burning goes off. The question is, what can we do? We are talking about pollution. We are talking about what a person can do. Policy, I am not talking about policy. It's a big issue which we can discuss later. But face mask, which has been publicized and used during COVID times, the WHO does not believe that face mask helps. Because WHO, when the discussion occurs, and I have been part of it, they talk about PM2.5 or 50 microgram, 25 microgram. They don't talk about 200 micrograms. My personal view is that N95 mask is a good mask to use during when the air quality is hazardous. It does protect us from particulate matter. With the caution that a mask with a valve can be used for air pollution, it should not be used for COVID. Air purifier, also WHO has dumped it. They said it does not help because there is no evidence, but lack of evidence is not against the contrary. There is evidence that it reduces the, improves the air quality, the particulate matter and ultrafine particulate by 50 to 90%. So therefore, for the people who have comorbidities, people who are elderly, those who have cardiac and lung disease, in the worst of the air quality time, one can use air purifier, but with a rider, that room should be closed. If you keep the window open or if your door is keeps on opening every few minutes for a tea or whatever, then air purifier will be nullified and it will be of no use. Finally, the frequently asked question to me is, should be exercise? So this was discussed in the WHO forum and various views were there, but the AQI, that is very publicized from minute to minute, if the AQI is good or moderate, then younger people can exercise. The older people should stay at home during the moderate. And if it is severe or hazardous, nobody should exercise. So it is important for us to go morning walks when a person, when the sunlight, right, when the inversion occurs, if the air quality is mild to moderate, one can consider exercise, a moderate exercise. That is what is internationally recommended. So finally, the pollution starts, is everybody's problem. And the responsibility is of everybody, of the policymaker, of the person who creates pollution. Pollution is a man-made problem. It has to be handled by men and suffered by men also. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Khilnani, for sharing that very high-level overview of the evidence in India. And I wanted to particularly flag that, Delhi is always the center of the discourse, and there's a lot of research that gets done in Delhi. But you did share with us that's also evidence and research that has been done in other metropolitan cities and tier two cities as well. I saw Pune and other places as well. So thank you so much. I will now request Dr. Prabhakaran to share his views on the cardiovascular effects of exposure to air pollution.
Thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me to give my perspective on air pollution and heart diseases. What I'm going to do in the next 5 minutes is address two or three questions. Most people know about the role of air pollution in lung disease, but not many are aware that air pollution actually increases heart disease. And I'll show some examples of one of the other things they ask is there really evidence? Because you keep saying that it causes heart disease, but is there really evidence? And so I'm going to give some empirical evidence. The third is what can be done about it? I'm not going to answer this. Probably in the panel discussion, we'll touch upon that. So the first question is, a lot of people think heart diseases means heart attack. So it goes beyond heart attacks. You have stroke. Because when we say cardiovascular disease, it involves the blood supply to the brain, and so there is stroke. It also involves gangrene of the foot because there's blood supply which is compromised to the peripheral parts of the body. This is heart failure where the heart becomes very tired, and as you can see, the heart is sweating and puffing. So heart failure is one of the other problems of heart diseases. Then, of course, we do have risk factors like high blood pressure or hypertension, diabetes, and obesity, which is actually an important cause of heart attacks and heart disease. And because of the direct effect, we can have irregularities of the heartbeat, heart, which can ultimately result in sudden death. So we all know that Indians have one of the highest risk for cardiovascular and diseases and diabetes in the world. It is said that nearly 20% of the heart disease can be attributed to air pollution. So it is an important risk for heart diseases. Now, how does this happen? Because a lot of people cannot fathom how heart disease can occur because of this tiny air pollution particle. Now, this is a hair follicle. As you know, a hair follicle is around 75 micrometer, which means it's something less than 1/10 of a millimeter, but it's visible to the naked eye. Now, PM2.5 is a really tiny, tiny particle, which is 1/30th of the hair follicle. That means if you cut the hair follicle into 30 pieces, one of those will represent PM2.5. That, when we breathe, enters the lungs. And it goes to the smallest unit of the lung called the alveolus, which prevents it from getting into the bloodstream. So there is a blood vessel and then the alveolus, which you call as the alveolar blood barrier. So it can cross that barrier because it's so tiny. Once it crosses the barrier, that barrier, it has three effects. One, it can directly affect the blood vessel. The lining on the blood vessel can be damaged and it can cause stiffness and what we call as atherosclerosis, which means a waxy substance is deposited in the blood vessels, particularly when they deposit on the arteries supplying the heart, you can have angina or chest pain. And when it's completely blocked, you can have a heart attack. The second that it can do is it can directly damage the heart, which can result in irregularity of the heart rhythm. It can result in sudden death. It can result in what is called as atrial fibrillation, and also can cause heart failure. The third mechanism is it can get deposited in the fat cells and make the fat cells active and cause inflammation. And that inflammation can lead to diabetes, insulin resistance, obesity, and several others. Now the question is there evidence for any of these? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use high blood pressure as an exemplar. We have shown it in diabetes, there's evidence for several other diseases, but I'm going to show hypertension as an exemplar. Most of the evidence in India has come from what we call as cross-sectional surveys, which means that you measure the PM2.5 level and measure the risk factor at the same level, which is not a great way of demonstrating relationship. So you need what we call as longitudinal relationship. That means you need to follow up these people over a period of time and see if they develop disease in relation to PM2.5. Now, how do you get the values of PM2.5 on a day-to-day basis? Because if you have to relate when people develop high blood pressure, we'll have to relate it to the short-term effect, the medium-term effect, and long-term effect. So you need to get PM2.5 on a daily basis. So what we did was we calculated the PM2.5 for Delhi. We did it for Chennai too, and we're doing it for other cities. But Delhi is 1,000, as you can see, is 1,500 square kilometer area. We divided Delhi into multiple grids of 1 kilometer into 1 kilometer. So we had close to 4.25 million observations. Now, for each of these grids, we had to get PM2.5. So we used monitoring data. So we have monitors in Delhi, around 25 monitors, which give you values for PM2.5 as well as PM10, which is a larger particle. And so you can actually model from that and get the PM2.5 value. The satellite gives you what is called as aerosol optical depth. And from that, you can calculate the PM2.5 levels. We have to adjust for land use variables. If you have green space, for example, PM2.5 levels will be low. So we have to calculate the green space. We have to calculate the transport network. We have to calculate the metro. We have to see how far away people are staying from wide roads or busy roads. Then we also need to adjust for meteorological variables, the wind speed, the rain, the humidity. Several of these factors can influence PM2.5 levels. Then we use a machine learning model and we use what is called as a special model called GeoSchem. It's a chemical transport model. And from that, we estimate PM2.5 levels. And as you can see here, these are data for over 6 years. And you can see for every year, the yellow color or the green color shows that the PM2.5 levels are okay. Red is really bad. And as you can see, as we move from 2010 to 2016, the red color starts appearing in the month of October itself. and last till February. So air pollution really increased from 2010 to 2016. And the second thing that we have shown is wherever people are staying very close to very congested area where there's a lot of traffic, their blood pressure levels are high. I don't want to get into too much of detail, but I just want to summarize that long and short-term exposure to high PM 2.5 concentrations are associated with increased blood pressure and risk of developing hypertension in urban India. We don't have data for rural India as of now. Every 25 microgram per cubic meter of PM2.5 increases blood pressure by 3.5 to 5 millimeters of mercury. To put things in perspective, the WHO recommends the PM2.5 on an average over a year to be less than 5. Here in Delhi, we have an average of more than 100. So every 25 microgram increases the blood pressure by 3.5 to 5. Some of you might ask, how does it really matter? My blood pressure is 120, it goes to 125. It's not hypertension at all. But at a population level, average increase of 3.5 to 5 millimeters is huge, because even reducing PM2.5 from current 100 to 75 can reduce the prevalence by 5%. And if you bring it to the national air quality standards, which is 40, we can reduce hypertension to 15% in urban Delhi. So that's the power of interfering and reducing, intervening and reducing air pollution at a higher level, at an environmental level. So there's links established with other diseases. We are also shown in diabetes, we'll publish soon, heart failure, stroke, obesity, heart attacks, and several others. There is evidence from international studies. I will come back during the panel and answer the question as to what can be done about it. Thank you very much for listening to my summary of air pollution and heart disease.
Thank you very much, Dr. Prabhakaran. Like, I think we have discussed this before, intuitively people link exposure to poor air quality to respiratory health, but very little is known about its impacts on cardiovascular health. So thanks for elucidating that to us. Thanks to all the clinicians who have given us this very insightful overview of the evidence of the research that exists, not just globally, but also and importantly in India. I will now request Mr. Manjeet Saluja, who represents the WHO office in India. Manjeet, my question to you, given this current landscape of the research evidence on the impacts of poor air quality on health, what is the WHO perspective and what is the WHO India office doing in terms of facilitating programs to facilitate air quality management?
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Poornima, for putting up this important question. So, but at the outset, first, let me thank the India International Center and Public Health Foundation of India for giving this opportunity to address on this important issue of public health concern. And I certainly congratulate the organization committee for convening this and focusing the attention on this important issue. And my also heartiest greetings to the entire IISc family who is listening today on this momentous occasions of their Diamond Jubilee celebrations. So I think my work has been made quite simpler by the August speakers before me. I've already shared the health impacts of air pollution on each and every organ of the human body. I think Dr. Paramesh has so simply put it that air pollution affects from womb to tomb. It's, you know, very simple, but it's scary. Yeah. So I think, let me kind of talk a little bit about solutions and as you have asked, share about WHO's work on this important issue and start with some kind of some recent historical landmarks. And when I say there was a landmark resolution which was titled Health and Environment, Addressing the Health Impact of Air Pollution, which was adopted by the 68th World Health Assembly on 26th of May 2015 in Geneva. So for many of the listeners who may not be aware of what WHA, the World Health Assembly is, so let me kind of say that the World Health Assembly is the main governing body of WHO, which comprises of all of 194 member states. And WHO is held every year. The World Health Assembly is held every year. And this time it was virtual. And the member states come together to agree on the organization's priorities and policies. And at this assembly, new health goals and strategies are set. And the tasks are assigned in order to kind of of know reach those goals. So the WHO, the World Health Assembly kind of know adopted this resolution, and as a part of the resolution, a draft roadmap was presented next year. Let me first kind of talk about what this resolution talked about. This resolution kind of talked about developing policy dialogue, partnerships, strengthening multi-sectoral cooperation, raising awareness in the public and among stakeholders, facilitating research, collecting and utilizing that data for relevant health risk assessments and surveillance of illness related to air pollution, and taking effective steps to address and minimize air pollution, even from the healthcare facilities, and identify actions by the health sector to reduce these health inequities related to air pollution. I think, so that was the main kind of tenets of this particular World Health Assembly resolution. And as I said, a draft roadmap was developed for an enhanced global response, which was adopted by the World Health Assembly in 2016. And the draft roadmap mainly kind of talked about four major components. And let me kind of go pillar by pillar, kind of talking about what the work of WHO across all the three levels, and in particularly focusing on the country office. So first and foremost, I think was the major mandate of WHO is to kind of enhance the knowledge base. So this pillar mainly focuses on the generation of evidence on the health impacts of air pollution. And each year, many of you are aware, that there's an estimate of a burden of disease which is attributable to air pollution is published in a gap of approximately 2 to 3 years. The last update was published in 2018, and a fresh update is coming up in the next couple of months. For the sake of simplicity, let me say that this pillar helps us to know what is the extent of the problem. So, and based on this evidence, which is kind of shared, and many research studies which are kind of taken up, there are guidelines which are developed and then kind of revised. As again, many of you may already be aware that recently WHO has revised and come up with the new air quality guidelines. And I think which my earlier speaker, Dr. Prabhakaran, also talked about the PM 2.5 value, which has now been revised to kind of 5, the annual value. And so there it kind of it provides clear evidence of the damage the air pollution inflicts on human health, even at lower concentrations than even previously understood. So the guidelines certainly recommend new air quality levels to protect the health of populations by reducing the level of key air pollutants, and some of which also contribute to climate change. And that's why this important discussion on climate and bringing air pollution as a focus is kind of very important. And again, these guidelines are not legally binded like all the WHO guidelines, but they are certainly an evidence-informed tool, if I can say, for policymakers to certainly guide the legislation and policies in order to reduce the level of air pollutants and kind of decrease the burden of disease, which results from exposure to air pollution worldwide and also in the country. In India, I think we are well aware of the extent. The previous speakers have already spoken about many research studies which have been taken up outside as well as in India as well. So there are many studies that have been conducted and are operational and gives us a fair idea of the extent. Certainly, we need more and more granularity of the data and kind of to help us know more precise solutions. But I think there is a good critical mass at present to certainly kind of talk about the solutions and at the same time keep kind of getting more and more studies. And I think even in the government of India, I think the previous speakers have talked about the ICMR study, which kind of talked about a similar estimates of the health impact of air pollution on the Indian population. And even kind of very recently, the National Center for Disease Control has kind of shared a compendium of case studies, which was a result of a consultation of WHO and Ministry of Health in October 2018. And so this compendium of studies in India talks about all the kind of studies, many of the studies, not all, but certainly many of the studies which are, and I think I can share a link maybe in the chat box as well, well. If somebody is interested to go through the kind of studies which are already operational or have been completed in India. So that's like on the extent of the problem, which is the enhancing the knowledge base. The second pillar, and maybe the next two pillars, are on more on the solution side, and kind of know they talk about raising awareness. And when I talk about raising awareness, it's kind of know mainly at the community level, focusing on the vulnerable population, and also for the overall community and the health workers and kind of know clinicians. The aim is certainly to create awareness among the community as they're able to kind of know, so that they can able to reduce the exposures. And also there is a demand also generated for cleaner air. So WHO certainly calls for the health and environment workers to be equipped through the education, training, and lifelong learning with certainly the knowledge, skills, values, and attitudes to address the sustainability, emphasizing kind of not tackling climate change and air pollution, and especially clinicians, where they can kind of know, like we have in our panel, the four August clinicians who can become cleaner champions, as they are, four of them are already cleaner champions, and we can kind of know have all the clinicians in India to become clean air champions, to advocate clean air by certainly highlighting the health effects of air pollution and kind of promoting viable solutions. And WHO is kind of developing a lot of training material to sensitize the clinicians, as well as in terms of, you know, the general population. And we have carried out work with the government, and also many of the institutes of repute and centers of excellence, like yours, Dr. Poornima, Public Health Foundation of India, on kind of developing such training material for community, for vulnerable population, for example, the traffic policemen, the rural women, especially who are exposed to the indoor air pollution. So that's where is on the awareness bit. But let me kind of take maybe 30 seconds more on to further elaborate. Let me also kind of share a global campaign of WHO, UNEP, UN Environment, CCAC, which is the Climate and Clean Air Coalition, and World Bank, which is called as the Breathe Life Campaign. So this is a global awareness kind of raising campaign that addresses the major risks to health and well-being of urban air pollution and climate change. And mainly kind of the campaign focuses on connecting cities, increasing monitoring, accelerating solutions, and kind of even empowering individuals, because ultimately some of the actions could be kind of at the individual level where people have to kind of come forward. And so this particular campaign has also made a headway in India. And in last couple of years, five Indian cities have committed to join Breathe Life campaign, and the municipal commissioners of those cities and mayors have pledged their support to work to improve air quality in their cities. Like, for example, cities of Nagpur, Dehradun, Bhubaneswar, Bengaluru have kind of have become a part of this Breathe Life network, and kind of have committed for the action on air pollution in their cities. On the policy side, I think so that's like mainly on the community and on the vulnerable population, but also on the policy side, WHO India has kind of been able to successfully advocate for the inclusion of the issues of climate in the health domain, and is kind of also constantly advocating for the health sector role in the environmental decision making of the country. As a result of the advocacy of WHO and many of our development partners in India, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare has made climate change as one of the focal areas under the National Health Mission, and a separate program known as the National Program on Climate Change and Health has been carved out, which is being implemented by National Center for Disease Control. The role of the health sector, especially in the environmental decision making, certainly is an ongoing process in the country. But there is considerable progress that has been kind of made in this particular regard. I'm happy to share as well that the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change and Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, with support from the UNEP Country Office and WHO Country Office, have formed a high-level steering committee on environment and health issues in the country in 2021. And two high-level meetings of this particular committee have already been held that saw the participation of both the Secretaries of Environment and Health Ministries, along with senior officials of other line ministries also, to come together and identify the work areas and solutions. So which kind of certainly kind of confirms that yes, this issue is being discussed with much kind of seriousness. The third pillar kind of talking about here would be on the institutional capacity kind of strengthening. And this pillar becomes kind of again very important, where especially we are talking about the sectoral interventions and how, and assessing the health impacts of these sectoral interventions and how the policy decisions of at the national and the district level can get informed through these health impact assessments, and where a decision maker at the district level, how he or she can kind of know evaluate multiple policy decisions through the help of certain simple tools, which can kind of know talk about the health impact, which can be coming out by the implementation of that particular policy initiative at the ground level. We have tools which are available on the public domain, for example, the Airquality Plus. So the health risk assessment certainly have the kind of, you know, potential to play a key role in the health promotion and disease prevention, both at the individual as well as at the population level. And the tools like Airquality Plus, what I said, they certainly allow the quantification of the health effects of exposure to air pollution, including kind of, you know, estimates of the reduction in life expectancy. So I think if I can just share Airquality Plus kind of, you know, estimates the effects of the short-term changes in air pollution, which is based on the risk assessment from the informed from the time series studies, and also the effect of the long-term exposures, which is informed from the cohort studies. So, and also we are kind of, you know, supporting the capacity building of the NPCCH, as I said, the National Program of Climate Change and Human Health, on related issues of even the vulnerability assessments and kind of, you know, other issues to make it like give a holistic perspective to it. The last, but certainly kind of, you know, one of the most important pillars is on the monitoring and reporting, and where we are kind of, you know, talking about as WHO is the custodian of the data for SDG3, and kind of, you know, also air pollution is kind of, you know, there even in other SDGs, SDG7 and SDG11. So again, that the previous the burden of disease study, which I kind of, you know, talked about, where WHO is collecting data even from most of the countries and also from India, the air quality data, and kind of, you know, producing these estimates in terms of the burden of estimate. And mainly at the country level, we're also trying to see how the air pollution surveillance, the mechanisms and the frameworks which are being implemented, how they can be kind of, you know, linked to the integrated health information platform which is being developed, and how this can kind of, you know, be together right since the beginning. So that's in brief in terms of, you know, the overall work of WHO at across three levels of the organization, and also kind of, you know, from WHO India perspective. Thank you.
Thank you, Manjeet. I mean, for giving us that very comprehensive overview of, you know, from the WHO level at Geneva down to the decentralized action at district level as well. I will now turn over to Mrs. Bavreen Kandari. Bavreen, you've been listening to what all these experts have been saying about the current research evidence on the impacts of poor air quality on health. But this is a problem and an issue that has become so critical to the lived experiences of people, you know, and particularly our children. Can you share with us now your perspectives on and your experiences on this issue, living here in the Delhi NCR region, and what motivated warrior moms?
Thank you, Dr. Poornima. First, again, thank you so much for including voices like as ours, you know, for warrior moms and parents, which, you know, usually are not so critical because the experts are there to say everything, but that is different. And that really doesn't happen. Everything has been said and all the, you know, wonderfully the experts have explained, but this is being said and we are no more in denial, as in when I'm saying we, it's the government now. It's not like 2001, you know, once on the national channel, I was told by a politician, you environmentalists have nothing else to do. So that's why now you're calling air is dirty, because water is dirty and food is dirty. So you've got something, you need something to do. So we are not there, we are all admitting, but still the, unfortunately, it doesn't really come into, you know, real action. And that is what we see. I have, of course, a little bit, you know, about myself, is I have twin girls now who have turned 18, but even before they were born, I was, you know, started, you know, researching a bit, you know, from the London smog and things like that. And as they were born, they were precious babies. And so you wanted to give them the best, you know, how every parent wants to, you know, whether it's cleanliness or the best food and things. But by 1.5 years of age, you know, they were, you know, both of them had terrible, you know, coughs and, you know, nonstop, you know, running noses and So obviously, you know, usually how the elders in the house and everyone says allergy or something, you know, and we used to get out of the country or out of the city, it would magically just go. Otherwise, for months, you would just suffer. So this was happening not to my kids, to mostly many other children around us. And it was something to worry about. But then, you know, people like us had no, we were not experts. And we needed doctors as here, you know, as all of you, the experts, and who were also working on it. And that's how we started joining hands and putting, our small campaigns together, along with all the data that was coming in to actually, you know, bring in the real sense of that, yes, the air is dirty and there is something really wrong about it. And it took me from 2003 to 2016, which is the first time when one day the schools were shut down. There was terrible smog in Delhi. And, we called for a protest in the evening. About 300 parents showed up and there was this movement that came up, which is called My Right to Breathe. And it was all parents there and, who were very concerned. And, because we could see that particular day you could see the smog. Normally air is difficult to make believe everyone that the air is dirty. It's wonderful to hear all this, but people don't believe it, that as I speak they're still breathing poison. So now my girls have turned 18, but if I say so, I have lost the battle because their lungs are damaged. I have not been able to do much for them. I've lived in the city. I continue to live here because I was fighting this battle when I had choices of leaving the city and going somewhere. But that's me, because some of us are privileged and we can still think about it. But many here on the in my esteemed panel, they spoke about, the underprivileged, people around us who don't even have the options, and some children who are living under the flyover here will never get to drive that car or use that flyover, but they're paying a price for that, life. So, there is I won't take much time because I also want to use my time hearing the others here, the experts here. And this was like, of course, myself and then many other mothers in different cities who joined hands, we're Pune and, Mumbai, Nagpur, Hyderabad, Gurugram, Kochi. Every mothers who felt the same way, and they were all, and this was of course another very important point, was that pollution was not only about Delhi. This is something that, again, something new, and now people are understanding that, but if you 3-4 years ago, no one would believe that pollution was only Delhi. So everyone now was concerned, and as mothers, of course, we didn't have much, so much resources or so much strength. But yes, we knew that we have to act on the violations, on all the gross violations that happen, which is whether it is tree cuttings or whether it is vehicular emissions or the garbage emissions or the thermal power plants. So there is laws for everything, but they're not being implemented on the ground. So that is where we join hands on, and we try to empower the other mothers and take it forward so that we can help and support the government. And unfortunately, one thing that I want to say here is that public health and air pollution, it's just comes together, but it's the same. You cannot go, air pollution is a public health emergency, but it's not being treated like one. The fact, like, I know everyone here, but they will not know anybody from air pollution. Similarly, now the Commission for Air Quality Management, there are really nobody from the Ministry of Health, because we don't believe it. We say it, but we don't believe it, that it is really a public health emergency. And every second that of lives that we are breathing in, and we are breathing the PM2.5, we are damaging lungs, whether it's ours, our children, and it's something common. So, as a warrior moms, our common enemy is PM2.5. And we, we are working in different fields, in different ways, in different cities, and support ourselves and the others to make sure that we can live a better life, our children can lead a better life. So this is what it is. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Babin. I mean, it's disheartening actually to hear, and then to hear it from parents, not just in Delhi, but across the country and cities everywhere, that it's the mothers who are now trying to raise the voice, you know, and make a passionate appeal for, you know, air quality management. It shouldn't be the case. It's like you said, my right to breathe. And so it's sad that we are where we are today. And thanks for all that you do to raise your collective voice. I'll now address a question, I think, to all the experts and ask you maybe to take a couple of minutes to respond on. You've all shared what you do as clinicians and practitioners. You know, you're seeing all this illness and that you attribute it to air pollution. But what roles have you focused on in particular in addressing the air pollution issue? I mean, take it from the perspective of the clinician. When you see your patients and you will see the illness when patients come to your OPDs or your consultation chambers, are you trying to do something to say to them about the preventive aspects, what can they do to make their lives better in relation to the poor air quality around them? So I'm going to ask, again, going back to Dr. Guleria and then Dr. Paramesh, Dr. Khilnani and Dr. Prabhakaran, what roles have you played in addressing the air pollution issue beyond what you do as your day job?
Yeah, thank you, Poornima. I think this question has led me to think, what more can I do for my patients and for my fellow obstetricians? So, definitely awareness is the key to prevention. So as an obstetrician, I think my role is at three levels: as an obstetrician, as a researcher, and on my personal level, what I can do for this problem. So as an obstetrician, what I think is that, you know, I have talked to my fellow obstetricians many times. The awareness about this problem, whether it really affects the pregnancy and the fetus, is really, really low. So what to expect of the general population and your patients, probably they won't be knowing much, especially the pregnant population. They hardly focus on this kind of, that this is also a serious concern for their pregnancy and for their fetus. So I think the first thing which I would like to kind of do is now have an awareness campaign, maybe for our fellow obstetricians, for our trainees, the postgraduates, and also what I see it here as that when we take the history of a patient, we always talk about that, you know, there is no history of smoking, no history of substance abuse. Or once I'm looking for the day when it becomes a part of your history taking, whether you are actually living in areas which are highly polluted, which have poor quality air. So unless that comes to your pen as equal to what other toxins, environment toxins we are talking about, it becomes a part of your routine antenatal history taking. And second, then also that, would you like to then, or do our fellow obstetricians routinely talk about the various do's and don'ts to our pregnant patient also whenever there is a, you know, concern about the poor air quality? Or do we generally talk about all those do's and don'ts? So that has also to become a part of our pregnancy advice or postpartum advice, you can say, whenever we discharge these patients, whenever we get in contact with these patients. So those do's and don'ts, which we all keep talking about, do we really transfer them or pass it on to our patients? That is very important. I don't think so. Even I also, when I look at myself, I think I hardly talk to my patients. Whenever there is so much, those winter months when the air pollution becomes a hot topic in the newspapers, I would say, okay, you know, you stay away from, look at the air quality index, stay away from your traffic areas, don't go out on mornings, evenings when the air is really bad, don't exercise. Or, you know, they sometimes ask me, should we buy air purifier? I do say yes. But then it's not a kind of routine advice which we give to our patients. I think this is what I think, the awareness which we need to have in our fellow obstetricians, make it a part of our routine obstetric care, make it a part of our routine antenatal history taking. So I am looking for that day. That day comes, that means I will see, I think that I have kind of success, have been successful as a obstetricians, and to create awareness among our obstetricians, fellow obstetricians. So that is one. Yeah. Second thing, which you know, I find that these days telling the women to use your N95 mask is much, much easier. Now they are all used to it. COVID has really done one good thing, that they are now quite used to the mask. They are not aware. So in case now we can start telling them that even if when the masks go off, when the COVID goes, you can still use them whenever you have a poor air quality. So I think that is going to help a lot. And
if I can ask you to wrap up, because I want to take some questions from the audience as well.
Okay. So I think the second thing which I want to tell you is that we should continue with our research as a researcher. And on the personal level, I should be kind of be voluntarily participating in reducing the carbon footprint on this earth. That is my responsibility. And one thing which I am very happy to share with you is our national association, that is FOGSI, is also has a subcommittee which looks into the environment. But it has come into the one of the subcommittees which is dedicated to environment and women's health. So that's a very positive effort.
Thank you. Yes, I do remember addressing the FOGSI participants a couple of years ago on environmental health issues.
So that's part of awareness campaign.
Yes, so including the conversations around air pollution in antenatal care, that's important, increasing awareness among obstetricians, and lastly, also, I think on personal protection, what you can do to advise your patients. So thank you so much. So quickly, a minute or two each to the other three clinicians on this question. What has been your role in addressing the air pollution issue? Dr. Paramesh. Dr. Paramesh, maybe you're muted.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, as Professor Manjeet Saluja said, knowledge-based propagation of the knowledge, I totally believe in that. As a clinician, when a case is referred, I spend more time on what is ill, health, ill, skill, well. What is your, when do you feel ill when the pollution is very high? When you see it is worst for you, which day, health, what is your medication, what is your pill, how do you take the medication, your skill, if you follow the environmental control, if you follow the guideline of the doctor, you are going to feel well. I take this one, adolescent, I talk to them. I take about 40 minutes for a case, when the referred case comes from them. It is difficult, but that's what I have to do as a clinician. However, as a researcher, and being the one of the part of the member of the WHO NGO climate change along with you, Poornima, that one. Need for quality education professional from different sectors is a must. And I being one of the member of the Indian Academy of Pediatrics, I think nearly 46 million people signed that paper, WHO thing, health related. So our organization, the first organization, Indian Academy of Pediatrics, representing that one, I made a statement, it is being documented in the WHO toolkit on climate change. That is what I want to make a statement here. 98% of the Indian Academy of Pediatric members are aware that climate change is occurring, and we are inspired by our traditional ethos of living in harmony with environment. These survey results reinforce that medical professionals must be taught about climate change in an integrated, comprehensive, a holistic way. In the Indians of science, they have taken, I'm the first medical doctor that, as a scientist they have taken in 112 years history. I'm become a link between the scientist and scientist. There is a gap is there, educating then scientist to society to bridge the gap and society to the scientist. That's what we have been organizing monthly programs everywhere under teachers and students. And we are educating children and also Rotary. We are all going there doing all this thing. It is our work. Action made this one. I think face mask came our study only, 1999. Traffic police, we did 1999. Traffic police are started using the mask in 1999. 2015, the better mask have come there. Banning the leaded petrol is our work. rules have been there, and also the decreasing the bursting of the cracker related to that one, our work, and also Burelal Committee has utilized our data, clean up the megacities as soon as possible, and also heavy bag, air pollution for the obstructive airway diseases, heavy bag make your spine, the spine problem cause hell of a problem in middle of your age. I think banning the backpack, not more than 10% body weight, is our work has been utilized in a way. I think there are action has been taken. It has to be propagated. In fact, it has to come like an emergency. There's no time to waste. Yeah. I agree with Manjeet Saluja very much.
Thank you, Dr. Paramesh. So across the board, I'm hearing awareness building, sensitization of different communities, not just of our own fraternities, of our clinicians and researchers, but also other audiences as well. So Dr. Khilnani and Dr. Prabhakaran, can I invite you to quickly?
So, pulmonologists becomes in the picture because air pollution enters through the lung and the first symptom is generally respiratory system. So I have played my role. Dr. Pandey was the one who inducted me into that emergency visit study, which we all are aware, which led to 23% increase in COPD and heart attacks and asthma admissions, which led to the lot of changes in the fuel quality. The Honorable Court drove away all the, then the CNG came. Subsequently, I did conduct study on children's study and blood, and then the AQI. I was part of that AQI committee, which under Dr. Mukesh Sharma, this was made, and currently I'm on the technical advisory group of global health. But as a pulmonologist, when I see a patient, which is very common, as I said, the people come with cough it's just one thing is that creating awareness and realizing that this is not infection. Majority of time during the surge of the air pollution, people come with respiratory complaints. They are not infective and they are unnecessarily loaded with antibiotics. Telling them to be aware of this and to minimize the exposure. How do you minimize the exposure? That I already been talked about, not to go to crowded places. Also, use of mask, which has been dumped by WHO, but we all believe that it works. Proper use of air purifier and proper maintenance of air purifiers. If all those are combined, I'm not going into the policy at all, which I have been a member of. But as a respiratory physician, my job is to advise them. And I used to tell them during the worst of the time, so many of my asthmatic patients to leave Delhi for a few days during Diwali time and go and live in some unpolluted area if they can afford that. I'll stop there in the end of time. Thank you.
Thank you. So, continuing the research job as well as, advocating for preventive aspects. Thank you. Dr. Prabhakaran.
So, thank you. I'm not the kind of practitioner clinician as my previous three speakers were. So I am mostly into public health practice. As a public health practitioner, what should I be doing? So I would say that we have to do involve three P's and become advocates for change to influence these three P's. And the three P's are the policymakers, the physicians, and the population at large, or the patients. So in that respect, what we have done is build capacity of physicians across the country through several of our capacity building work in terms of air pollution. B, I've been part of the WHO, World Heart Federation Air Pollution Expert Group, and we have created an advocacy piece which is being disseminated across the world, most of which actually has some many elements of what Mr. Saluja said, and so we are using that. The second thing is, I always believe that you have to generate evidence, and we have generated some evidence in terms of the linkage, because people had been questioning that is air pollution real and does it cause this or does it cause that? So we generated the evidence. But more importantly, knowing is not enough, as Juan Gaeta said, we need to act. And so in that sense, we are generating further evidence by research in terms of how do you get low-cost monitors? For just to give a perspective, the current low-cost air purifiers. The current air purifiers cost around 20,000 to 30,000. Suppose we bring it down to 2,000 to 3,000 rupees, and we prevent two hospitalization for a heart failure patient, it saves a lot of money for the patient as well as the system. And that's where we are working in terms of trying to get these low-cost air purifiers and doing a clinical trial. Actually, it has been funded by NIH and ICMR to see whether we can reduce deaths, repeat stroke and hospitalization for patients with heart failure. I'm just giving one of those examples. There are several other interventions which we do. The second thing is air pollution is contextual. What happens in Delhi may not be true of Chennai. So you need to look at what is the species of air pollution that causes. So that's the second generation evidence. The third is the socioeconomic dimension is never discussed. Actually, within the city of Delhi itself, within a 400 square meter area, the exposure to ambient air pollution is much higher amongst people who are living in slums, people who are living in these one house tenements because of the combination of indoor air pollution as well as outdoor air pollution as well as secondary smoke. So clearly those kind of evidences, because you need to intervene at them, intervene there and make special efforts to reduce air pollution. I'll stop here. The gender dimension is another important thing. Even people who are living in the same house amongst these poor people, the husband though goes out and comes, the exposure to PM2.5 is much lower than the woman who's cooking in a one-room tenement without any ventilation. So these are the things that we need to generate. And I particularly like the moms for creating that advocacy. We need to work with them, support them, and make this a big moment. I'll stop here. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr.
You're muted.
Thank you, Dr. Prabhakaran. I would like to now turn over back to Manjeet, if you'd like to take a couple of minutes to respond to some of the issues that were raised by, a couple of times mentioned about the masks. Would you like to respond to that, as WHO hat is worn by you here?
Okay. I think in terms of masks and air purifiers, I think there are a couple of considerations which we also need to be aware. And I think where there have been discussions around it. There is a whole discussion on the practical advice. And there, I think when you are facing the kind of the PM2.5 levels, especially during the episodic, there is no other way. You have to use masks or air purifiers. The advisories from WHO have been consistent in terms of reducing the exposure, and that's what is important. And I'll come as to why masks and air purifiers are not in that particular. But then, in first, the advisories are certainly, as I think it was said, to stay indoors. In particularly children, people age over 60 years, people with heart or respiratory diseases, asthmas, and other debilitating conditions. When indoors, ensure the sources of indoor air pollution are absent, whether it's tobacco smoking, indoor combustion, heating, frying, and keep windows shut. Vulnerable populations to avoid physical exercise outdoors. And if available, using HEPA air filters in your home can help reduce exposure, but we also have to see the whole equity dimension out here. I think the health inequities, and we cannot further exacerbate by advising on air purifiers, and because saying where the majority of the population may not be able to afford that but again, people who can certainly afford, and where the air quality is particularly poor, there is no other solution. The evidence is currently being evaluated by WHO, and the further guidance would be provided soon on the issue of air purifier. The efficacy of masks is quite variable. First of all, I think I have also seen in the chat window, there's a lot of questions on masks in terms of only those masks that have been fitted and worn properly have been shown to be effective at reducing exposure to health damaging pollutants. We are talking about fabric masks worn by commuters, or even what we did one in COVID. They are not useful for PM2.5. And so that's not going to reduce the air pollution and the exposure. And also, especially in terms of masks, because of the facial anthropometric differences all across the world, we're not sure that any particular respirator can be guaranteed to fit all users. I'm myself example. With the beard, the mask kind of does not fit completely, and ultimately there is a kind of psychological that I'm being protected, but actually I'm not being protected, and I need to kind of reduce my exposure by staying indoors and rather than going out with an N95 and with saying that okay, I'm being protected. And also somewhere the whole issue of masks also is also from the perspective of yes, where there is a problem we need to use it, but they are end of pipe solutions. We also need to continuously keep working to capacitate and work with the policymakers and implementers in enforcement of those policy decisions, so that the air pollution at source gets reduced rather than only using. And so those are the discussion points. I'm not saying anything towards right or wrong, but those are the discussion points and considerations which we need to keep before we trying to advocate. But yes, certainly moving towards more of awareness and getting information in the public domain on these issues. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Manjeet. I think the mask issue, I think there were a lot of questions raised in the chat. You addressed some of those. I think there's, yes, the correct masks to be worn in the high pollution days, but also otherwise definitely afford protection. So there's no question about that. I know there are a few questions that I quickly want to take from the chat box. So I think Dr. Guleria, you had already addressed this maybe, but can you give a quick answer to somebody who's asking, do mothers too need to wear heavy masks during pregnancy when there is poor air quality? I think you've already addressed it, but a quick yes or no and a 30 seconds answer if you can.
So I think it's a good idea. I feel now since we are so used to it, and heavy mask means N95 or that. Sure. So I think... And of course, as Dr. Manjeet has already said, it is a correct use and correct mask, which is going to help them. All of them cannot always stay indoors. That would be best. But if they go out on such a day, they should.
Okay. So there's one question. I think this she has posted the question twice because I think we haven't addressed any questions so far, but I'm seeing the answer questions in the chat box now. There's a question on the speed of traffic at 10 kilometers per hour produces higher carbon monoxide than 75 kilometers per hour. Maybe that was in your slide, Dr. Paramesh. Is that?
Yes.
I think it's because of the, maybe I'll let you answer.
Slow traffic produces more emissions. That car, this is the National Institute of Traffic Association, it has come from the institute only. The data is available.
Yeah, so this is also why we worry about, the school buses, for instance, idling for long hours, for long periods of time when they're, allowing children to get into the bus or get off the bus. The idling of traffic is a very well-known cause of, emissions and short-term exposure.
Definitely, I agree.
Yeah, so I think we've addressed that question. I think the question of a couple of questions on do we need a disease registry for air pollution? Dr. Khilnani, can I turn to you for that? Is there any disease registry in India related to air pollution or asthma or a COPD?
I'm not aware, but there are several studies which are conducted by TERI. There are other agencies also, all in the institute also. One cross-sectional study on children's city we conducted. But I'm not aware of any registry directly related to air pollution which is there. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So there's a question to the cardiologist as well, Dr. Prabhakaran. There is evidence that inhalation of polluted air activates hemostasis in the people who have cardiovascular risk. Can you tell us about the initiating pathways for thrombosis is the question from the audience.
Right. I'll answer two questions. The first one which you asked, Dr. Khilnani, there is a registry by acute heart attack registry by the Cardiology Society of India, in which they are looking at air pollution and its relationship to acute myocardial infarction. That's a very short answer to that previous question. The second question, what was it? Sorry.
About the pathways to thrombosis.
I just wanted to keep it simple. I agree that air pollution actually converts what we call as in the autonomic nervous system. That's the third type of nervous system that we have, which regulates the internal milieu of the body. So with air pollution, the internal milieu becomes more what we call a sympathetic activity. I mean, sympathetic activity is related to stress. It's related to our reaction to any kind of threat that we have. And therefore, there are several hormones that are produced. And as part of that, there is increased propensity to form a clot or a thrombosis, which is the technical term for a clot. I didn't mention that because I just wanted to keep it simple and have those three things mentioned. Yes, of course, it does increase sympathetic activity and increases the propensity to clot formation.
Yeah, so I think you kind of also addressed another question that was in the Q&A on the stress itself. How does exposure to air pollution lead to routine stress? So thank you for doing that. And I think there's one question on air purifiers. So plants as air purifiers, and there's one more related to use of air purifiers in cars. Does anybody want to take that quickly? I know that will be our last question from the floor.
Oh, if I could answer that question.
Sure, sir.
You know, air purifier does not mean a simple air purifier. It has got two components. One is a filter, other is adsorbent. Adsorbent, not absorbent, AD, adsorbent, which actually sucks the gases, soluble gases from it. So when you use an air purifier, then the quality should be good in the sense that it should have a filter as well as adsorbent. Other thing is that the size of the potency of the air purifier should be commensurate with the volume of the room. It's not that you keep an air purifier in your living room and you think that the whole house will be purified. Third thing is the room has to be completely airtight in the sense that it should not have a window slightly open or the door continuously being opened and closed for some tea, coffee and all those things, water. This gets nullified. And finally, the maintenance of the purifier is important in the sense that cleaning of the filter and the changing of the filter and servicing as far as the adsorbent is concerned is important. If you do all this, this is, to my mind, is useful only for people who have comorbidities. The WHO has dumped it, actually. Dr. Manjeet would know that. I was part of that committee. I kept screaming that please consider countries like India where air quality is very bad, but they said no, there is no evidence. But as far as the car air purifier is concerned, the same principle would apply. There's no scientific evidence that it works, but if it is a good air purifier and the person has got morbidities, severe comorbidities, it can be used, but to my mind, evidence is lacking. Thank you.
Thank you. So I think we've kind of addressed all the questions that were there in the Q&A box. But so if I can, Manjeet, if I can give you 1 minute to address the question on what is the future work that's WHO is doing with the Ministry of Health. I know that India is also looking at revising its national ambient air quality standards. Is there a role for the health sector, given that by hearsay, we know that there was not much taken into account from the health impacts of air pollution in the previous development of the standard. So has that changed for the upcoming revision of NACs, and what is WHO doing about it, if at all?
Okay. Very quickly, I think, as I've already shared, that yes, especially the role of the health sector in the environmental decision-making of the country is certainly an ongoing process. And as you have kind of rightly identified, yes, I hope the next revision is kind of more health-informed and kind of more evidence-informed and based on the health-based guidelines. But in terms of the WHO's role, I think WHO is kind of committed to supporting the government and the partners at all levels. And I think we also have even the global kind of bodies, which are like, for example, Dr. Paramesh and Dr. Prabhakaran also touched upon some of the advisory bodies. There's another one on kind of particularly on global body on air pollution and health. There's a technical advisory groups, which is kind of acting as an advisory body to WHO to provide the technical guidance and inputs to support WHO's work. I think one of the experts on this panel, Dr. Khilnani, is also kind of a part of this particular body. So I think what we will certainly kind of we'll continue to advocate for the issue at the highest level. And let me share out here that even on the upcoming World Health Day of 7th April 2022, WHO is kind of going to focus the global attention on urgent actions which are needed to keep the humans and also the planet healthy and foster a movement to kind of create, which are societies focused on well-being. So the theme for that World Health Day 2022, 7th April, which has been recently announced, is our planet, our health. And WHO, there would be a lot of campaigns which will urge governments and public to kind of share stories of steps that are kind of taking to protect this planet and their health and prioritize kind of the well-being society. So we would be kind of certainly continue to focus on this. But let me end by saying that certainly there's no single stakeholder that can address this particular issue through individual efforts. And we all have to come together and certainly kind of enhance a quick, coordinated, multi-sectoral and sustained response to this problem, which is of immense importance to the public health and kind of to the country. So congratulations once again for today's meeting, and maybe I'll stop over here. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Manjeet. I think you put it very aptly. I think we need a very coordinated, coherent response to this public health issue. I'm going to give the final word to Bavreen. As a mother and a passionate advocate for environmental issues, especially air pollution now, Bavreen, what are your takeaways from this deliberation? Because at the end of the day, it's the experience on the ground. We can make all the guidelines, all the programs and the policies and try implementing it through an intersectoral coordinated action. But at the end of the day, it's the lived experience on the ground. So what are your takeaways from this deliberation here today with all of the different stakeholders to safeguard the health of our children and the lives of our children in the years to come?
Yes, Dr. Poornima, this has been absolutely enlightening. And obviously, they're all wonderful people and the experts that we know, they are saying this, but I'll just be, maybe I may sound a little cynical, but, Professor Saluja and, all the people who are influencing the policymakers, we can't do as much as they can. It's about the sources of pollution. See, even the audience who is speaking, they're asking us questions. Everyone is talking about purifiers and masks, and then the policymakers love smog towers and stuff like that, gadgets. Even the CAQM has these non-stop meetings and they just want to talk gadgets and new stuff. That is not going to work. If we are really thinking this is a public health emergency, we'll have to work on the sources of pollution. And we'll request you all, because that's our take on the ground, and we are pushing that, whether it's an indoor pollution or chula, or is it something as simple as garbage burning, or is it a tree cutting, whatever it is, it all has to work. Those are the things that we need to work on mostly, and not this commercial capitalist ways of solving a solution. So we are not going to get anywhere, and all of you can do that for us. We know that, because you are the voices, you are the experts, you are the scientists, you are the everyone who makes this data happen. And thanks to all this data that we can go ahead, and now the WHO coming up, they came out with the new data. That's what we push and we try to work on campaigns. So together, yes, like Professor Saluja said, yes, and thank you, Dr. Prabhakaran, for saying that, yeah, we want to work together with everyone and, be the voices for our children, for everybody's sake. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you, Bavreen. I mean, I think you said it like it is. It's good. It's good that we have all the science, we have all the clinicians, the experts, and the researchers here to do that for us. But I think at the end of the day, what we need to address is what's happening on the ground, reality, as it were. More power to you. And thanks for mentioning the smog towers. Those things don't work. And I want to actually close now. I know we're a little over time over here, but thank you so much for all patiently joining us and staying on in this panel discussion here today. I think it was a very, very topical issue of relevance to public health, to all our families, our children, and to the environment at large. So thank you, Professor Guleria, Dr. Khilnani, Dr. Paramesh, Dr. Prabhakaran, Sumanjeet Saluja, and Bavreen for joining us here today. Thank you to all the organizers, and congratulations to Indian International Center too on their Diamond Jubilee celebrations, and for taking this very important initiative of bringing the issues of public relevance to the forum here and holding these discussions. I think they're doing it every week, literally, and I think it's important to have these discussions. Thank you for taking your time to join us here today. It was wonderful.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so
very
much. Excellent.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much.
Lani, Manji sir, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you.